test.
So was there a specific story that got you into this story? Was there something that happened or something you read or?
No, it's the departure point was the mourning of the characters. But I was also really interested in the violence on schools and well, especially on bullying and violence at schools. Mm-hmm. And then it all started developing organically or by itself. I try when I write to let the ideas flow and not to be very strict on what I want to say, just let them flow. So,
because it does seem in the beginning it's more of his story, and we're kind of, I think as you're watching the movie, you're expecting it to be his story more, and then it really becomes her story.
Yeah, but about that, I gotta say that I really like films that are not so, let's say, well done or perfectly, you know, like balanced, and I don't like that because life itself is not like that. So I try to follow the movie and let the movie speak instead of imposing.
All right.
I don't know if it makes sense to you.
It does. I mean? The thing is his journey is required for her journey to make sense.
Exactly.
Really,
I mean, hopefully at the end it all makes sense and it's well balanced, but not in a formulaic, typical rhythm or way.
So when do you know you're done with the script?
You're never really done with the script, especially now. I shot two movies last year, so I was really hands-on. And now I'm really sure that you're never done with the script. That if you're the writer and director, then you keep on writing while you're shooting, and you keep improvising, and you keep, well, that's the way I'm working now, keep changing things. And I find it a more interesting process because you're adapting everything to what's actually happening. Again, let the movie speak, not force the ideas into the movie.
So is there an example of something that went off in a different direction that you expected as you were in production?
Well, to begin with, the script was first written for a boy, not a girl. But then I thought about Tessa, who I already knew from before, and her friends, her actual friends in life. And I adapted the whole thing for her, and I wrote different and specific parts for her friends. So that's an example of, I had a script and then I changed it for the actor, so it's not really clear when the script is done. And then, for example, as another example, when I was already shooting, I reshoot many scenes because I was editing at the same time. And if I didn't like it for the second time, I would shoot it a third time with different dialogue or with whatever change was needed, was required. So at the beginning, you're writing with words and then you're writing with images and with actors.
So do you budget for that or do you just, are you quick? Are you that fast?
I'm pretty quick, but also I'm the main producer of the film, along with other producers, of course. But since I'm the main producer, I don't really need to ask if I'm, can I do this, can I do that? I just do whatever I want. And the money's always enough. I don't want to speak bad about producers, but I found that the typical way, the old school, and producing is not really effective. You can do so much more when you really know what you're doing. And when you're the filmmaker, you really know what you're doing and what you need. And there's, I think many times money's spent wrongly, badly, because they're trying to guess what the director needs or trying to have everything covered.
Right.
Or being so professional, you know. So I don't have the problem.
It's funny because in America, there's this, you know, independent movement that has a lot of people who are doing, using their own cameras and doing things like that, much smaller production. And as they're becoming more popular and getting studio funding, they're finding that it's actually harder to kind of deal with all of that.
For example, on my first film, I had a 60 people crew and I had all kinds of professional, whatever, this and that. And it was horrible because there was no flexibility. I had to ask for permission to change even, you know, if I wanted to shoot this instead of that or on this place instead of that, it was like, no, that's very hard because we already, all the trucks are there and, you know, the cables and the staff and the, and everyone's supposed to arrive to that location. And on this case, when I wanted to change something, it's just like call two people, they'll call two or three other people and that's the rest of the crew.
Right.
And end of story, I can really do whatever I want, so it's great.
So as your budgets grow, and I assume you'll want them to, or you're not so sure you really want them to, you have that look on your face.
What I think about budgets, it doesn't really matter if it's a big or a small budget, it's just the required budget for every specific film. I wouldn't mind, it's all the same, making a $10 million or a $50 million film or a $1 million film, it's all the same. You just do what you gotta do.
And but all those structures that you don't like are come often with a $50 million film.
Yeah, of course I wouldn't run into it if it's not necessary.
Yeah.
And then it's funny, then when there's more money, it's same old story, there's never enough money. So you often say, you cannot do this or cannot do that. And my film, you know, it's I got to shoot wherever I wanted and whatever I wanted. I took many actors to the beach. You know, we had to travel with a lot of actors. We had a lot of extras. So there's no limit to what you can do.
Are you traveling with are your actors in this movie the kids of age, or does that matter as much in the in Mexico as it does here? It's a big issue here about how you deal with them.
They were 16, most of them, when we were shooting. I'm very close to most of the parents, or at least I approached them.
Right.
And they really trusted me. Two of them are brothers to the actors of my first film. So that helped. And Tessa, I already knew, I'm very close to the family, so that helped. And
so the parents travel with you, or are you
No.
They're a little too sophisticated for that. See, in America, it's a lot of hand-holding until they hit 18, I guess.
Yeah, but that would have gotten in the way. That's really great about Mexico, that we don't take certain things so seriously. And everything's fine, you know.
Right. So would you, as a filmmaker, did you have to worry about that line? Did you feel like you were walking a line of where, I mean, the movie goes about as far as you can go. Was there any sense of, uh-oh, I may be going too far, or this may be pushing too hard?
Like,
or
with the kids and so?
And the work and what the film is, what's happening in the film.
Well, with the content of the film, no, I was very secure. I really knew what I was doing. I mean, I knew there were risks involved, but I wanted to take those risks, and I think all the films I like are like that. They get into how do you say it? Not such easy ground,
right?
Because if not, maybe you're not really touching interesting matters. And in terms of the shooting, well, we did what we had to do. It was a bit risky sometimes, like, you know, water scenes at night and the drinking. There was a little drinking on the set, of course.
Do the kids like pushing that themselves, or were they, I mean, it was part of the fun of them for performing in this film? Pushing that boundary and being really, really mean. I'm sure the mean girls and the mean guys are not quite as evil in real life as they're in this movie.
No, they're not evil at all, and they're close friends to the main actress, so it's easier being slapped by your best friend than by any actor or someone you don't know, and you're gonna be slapped harder, you know, because they trust you and you trust them. So the chemistry between them and the years of knowing each other before really, really helped me. I took that as if there were years of rehearsal. And actually, we didn't rehearse, so that was a good mix.
And do you have to bring them down a little to make it real, or are they right in the groove? I mean, it seems like those performances could have been over the top a little bit, or they could have gone in some weird places, but they're very subtle, really. They really feel real.
Yeah, well, comes to begin with from the script, because I wrote it for them, so that's easier. And then, well, it's a matter of style, I guess. I like working that way. I don't like exaggerating and. Mm-hmm.
But does that take a lot of direction, a lot of hand-holding, or are you?
Well, sometimes the opposite. Sometimes it's important not to direct too much. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you can spoil a very good performance by saying too much to an actor, you know. Mm-hmm. So it depends on every scene, depends on every moment of every actor. Some need more, but these kids, they were very natural. It was very, mm-hmm. very. The trick is to trick yourself. You have to trick yourself into thinking that it's easy, and make them believe it's easy when it's actually very hard. Something like that.
And how much of it happens for you in post? Is it are you big on changing things in post, or do you feel like you pretty much have an idea of where you've?
No, I'm big on reshoots. I love reshooting whatever is necessary, mm-hmm. and not feeling that I had to deal with as much. I mean. I do whatever is necessary in reshoots.
But it sounds like it's happening while the reshoots are happening while you're in production because you're cutting while you're in production.
Most of them. But some others went a month later. Mm-hmm. And we had to cut the hair again, for example.
So how do you keep yourself sane cutting and shooting at the same time?
It's, well, forget about Sundays and Saturdays and Sundays, no rest. Mm-hmm. But on the other hand, when production's over, the final cut's almost there, or at least you know the film's there or not. Mm-hmm. The idea of wrapping up a film without being sure if you got it seems absurd to me. So
it's kind of crazy.
Things are changing. I mean, technology is getting better and better. Mm-hmm. Why not take advantage of it? And yeah, it's a lot of work shooting and editing, mm-hmm. but at the same time, it's really helpful because not only for reshoots, but since I'm about to shoot, I can change them according to what I already shot. So mm-hmm. it's a much, much more interesting process.
So what's your sense of, once you're completed the film, of what your satisfaction with how it's accepted? Is it the film, is it getting into Cannes? Is it how the audience reacts in that theater when you're watching it with them, or?
Well, I just had my first screening for this film yesterday, mm-hmm. at the Certain Regard. It was amazing. it's hard for me to say it because it's as if I'm showing off, but I was surprised to see people, you know, a long-standing ovation and mm-hmm. people crying. That was the best, watching people cry, because then I was sure that they were touched and moved, and I was sure the film was going to be interesting, mm-hmm. Because of the subject matters. Mm-hmm. But I wasn't that sure. I was aiming for it, but I wasn't that sure if it was going to be so moving and it was going to touch him deeply, and it did. So I cannot ask for more. I mean, being at Cannes and feeling so accepted is just great.
Were you targeting Cannes? Were you hoping that this would be the premiere? And or were you thinking about just whenever you finish the film, whatever the next great festival was, you might start there?
Sorry?
Were you thinking about Cannes when you were finishing the film and figuring your timing and everything?
I mean, you always want to end up here when you're a director, I guess. At least myself, it's the best festival in the world, but I had another film. I made two films last year, so mm-hmm. I wasn't that anxious because I had already sent one. So I was hoping at least I got two shots.
So what's happening with the other film?
I need a festival to screen that one, to premiere that one.
So maybe Toronto?
Could be. I'm not sure, yeah. Well, as soon as possible, because the film is quite ready.
So when will you make your next film? Is it going to be a year from now we'll see another film here?
I don't know.
Are you that quick?
I need to relax a bit. No, I need to sit down and write. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure I'm going to have to be promoting these two films for at least a little while.
Well, what made you get into the situation where you had two films at the same time?
The fact that for the other film I didn't have to write a script. It's based on a short film I made 10 years ago. Mm-hmm. So I had no script, but I had a very clear idea of what I wanted to do. And I worked closely with my sister, who's also a director, on that film. It was a 4-month shooting, because most of it takes place on the street with, homeless people. There's only one professional actress. So it's a different movie, but it's fiction after all. And I think when people watch the three films, my three films all together, it'll make sense. It's all coming from the same director.
So do you have a community in Mexico of young filmmakers like yourself? That, I mean, you have your sister, but it doesn't sound like, I don't think you're part of the Three Amigos. You're kind of the next generation from those guys. Is there a young up and coming community of filmmakers that you're part of?
Well, we are some sort of community in terms that we help each other and we're friends. I'm a close friend of Michael Rowe, or I know Fernando Emke, Gerardo Naranjo. We all know each other, but we're all really different. I'm at Escalante, but I think there's, it's not like a wave in terms of what the films are about or the way they are shot. Everyone has its own voice, which is actually more interesting, I think.
So do you think Mexican film has changed a lot in the last number of years?
Well, yes. I think it's changing along with the worldwide cinema, and there's emerging filmmakers, film industries everywhere. Has to do with the technology, has to do with many things.
So are commercial considerations greater or lesser over at this time for
you? The commercial what, sorry?
The commercial considerations for trying, I mean, it did seem like there were a lot of films coming out of Mexico trying to be kind of reach the United States and reach France and other parts of the world. And this film seems to be more unforgiving, I guess, of, you know, it doesn't feel like you made this film so that you could, you may have a big audience for it, but it didn't feel like you made it for a big audience.
I always try to reach an audience as broad as possible. I try to make the film as interesting and entertaining as possible, but I'm not gonna sacrifice or compromise any of the ideas in search of a bigger audience, because it would be silly anyway. I might do that and not get a bigger audience.
Right.
I think if I'm if I do what I have to do, if I'm respect the audience, I might find a bigger one. There's no formulas, I guess. Even though many people claim that they know how to reach a big audience, I don't think so.
I think the you try and then maybe don't get it is a problem for people. A lot of people give up a lot of things and then don't hit the note and then it's over.
Yeah, I think that's absurd. At least I'm doing exactly what I want, and I don't know, for the reactions I got from yesterday, I mean soon, but I might get a lucky break and may the film find its audience everywhere, because I do think it's a very accessible film. I mean, it's you don't have to be a film buff to a very how would you say you don't have to be an expert on film or whatever. You can
I think you have to have been a kid or have a kid.
Yeah, that's it. That's it. It's very human, I hope. Very humane.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting that your jury, the foreman of your jury is Tim Roth, because his film, the one he made, Warzone, is equally painful to watch. And it was interesting sitting there in the theater, knowing he was sitting there, and that, because it is a really visceral, physical experience to watch your film. And my heart was pounding through most of the film because I was so upset and so angry and so, you know, so taken with that moment. And Tim had done that for me as well back with his film, so.
Yeah, hope he likes it.
And so what made you want to be a filmmaker in the first place? Why film?
Well, I think it's a privilege. It's a great opportunity to be heard to. I mean, for example, yesterday there was like 1,000 people at the theater following my ideas, and that's
but did you want that when you were 8? Did you want that when you were 12? What was the
no, I wanted to be a musician, but then I found out I had no talent whatsoever.
That could be a problem.
I gave it a try on cinema when I was 18, 19. Mm-hmm. And kind of make more sense to me. To people that surrounded me, it sounded as ridiculous as being a musician, but
so you started making
out.
Short films, or?
I what?
Started making short films? Or?
Yeah, I started making short films. I didn't study filmmaking. I mean, I didn't go to film school. I didn't attend film school, so I was studying media communications. Mm-hmm. So I started shooting short films like crazy, like one after the other. So I made like 10, 12 short films, and half of them were really bad. And the other half kind of made sense and managed to tell a story. Mm-hmm. And I learned more from those that made no sense, actually.
Just
I think the only way to become a director is actually doing it.
Mm-hmm. And has your family been supportive the whole time? Is this, everybody think it was a good idea?
Yeah, they always let me do whatever I wanted and so, but they didn't really believe that it could work.
So this is, that must be a bit of a shock to them.
Well, they're very happy. They're all here at the festival, and they're very supportive in that way. I don't blame them. Saying I want to be a filmmaker sounds, I mean, still myself, couple, 3-4 years ago, I didn't feel comfortable saying I'm a filmmaker. It still sounds a bit silly, huh?
So do you have a wide range of things you want to make films about?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. It's, I don't know if you saw my first film, but some people are making too many connections between the first and the second film.
Uh-huh.
And they're suggesting or thinking that I'll be always around the same subject matters, but no, it's more of a chance that they're similar in many ways. Mm-hmm. I'm into whatever comes to my mind. I already have a few other ideas. Although I have to say, when I end up sitting on the computer and writing, mm-hmm. it turns out everything's a bit similar. Even I don't realize at the beginning, and then it's like,
right.
Jesus, I made the same thing, which might be good, I don't know.
Well, I think that most of the best filmmakers have some sort of voice or some sort of thing they're trying to get out. I don't know.
Yeah, the best ones have one or two obsessions, and they keep. I think Fassbinder said that any decent filmmaker has one single real subject or something like that.
Because Wes Anderson actually said the same thing earlier this week, that he doesn't see his films as similar at all. And then he does interviews and people say, wow, that film was like this and that film, and they're all connected. And he's like, I don't know what you're talking about.
I really like Wes Anderson, for example. It has nothing to do with my work, of course.
Right.
Yeah.
So are there filmmakers you particularly admired, or have you just kind of crafted your own sense of how to do things?
Well, I tried to find my own voice, because if not, what's the point? But of course, you steal from everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, I watch a lot of films, especially since I am self-taught. The only way of learning is watching films and shooting film and reading about directors.
So do you have a chance to watch in theaters, or did you watch on DVD? Or
I enjoy much more watching films. For example, it's absurd, but I haven't watched Melancholia from last year, mm-hmm. because it hasn't been released in Mexico. And I know it's going to be released like in a month, so I'm still waiting for
You're holding out.
Yeah, I want to see it on the theater, not on Blu-ray or anything.
Mm-hmm. But the old films, or are you a fan of the old? I mean, what is your
I'm a huge fan of the old films. When I wrote this script for After Lucia, I wrote it in Paris. I was living there for 6 months, mm-hmm. during the residence of the festival, the mm-hmm. La Cine Fundación. And I used to go to the Cinémathèque and Forum des Images, and these places where they actually were playing a lot of old American films, and it's great,
yeah,
all the classics.
Unfortunately, we've lost most of that in America now. Those theaters are all closed. It's very rough. Even in New York and LA, it's hard to find. There are not very many revival houses left.
Yeah, it's all changing, and I don't like that part of the change, because I do like theaters, and yeah.
Do you feel anything about it in terms of your own work? Do you mind whether people see it on a DVD or in a theater, or how they have the experience?
Well, a big screen is always better, not only because of the size of it, but you know, a dark room where the phone's not ringing and you're not able to pause it to go to the toilet every time you want. Yeah, the theater is like kind of a temple or something. It's beautiful.
Well, this film definitely, people would, I think, probably pause it a lot and go run and hide. I can imagine a lot of people being squeamish along the way. And you kind of want to have that full experience. I think in some ways this film, as much as any film that's been in the festival, you want to have that thing where you're with people and you're hearing the sound of people experiencing it, and you want to be trapped on some level.
Yeah,
the movie.
Yeah, it's better to watch it like a movie should be watched on a theater full of people. Yesterday was beautiful. Yeah.
So can you watch it like a movie at this point? Are you still watching every cut or every?
Well, I guess one is never able to really watch it as a film. It's what's important to say about that question is that I had to force myself into watching it as a film when I was editing, in order to be objective, in order to know if a shot's too long, if it gets boring. I'm really afraid of being of boring people, you know. Mm-hmm. So now I cannot watch it as a film. I see all the tricks, I see all the mistakes, I see everything I could have done better. But while editing, I force myself into it. Yeah.
And do you just put it away when you're done emotionally, or are you done when you're finished the cut, or are you still, does it linger with you for a while?
No, I'm done. I'm through. I'm into the next thing.
You're ready for the next thing?
Yeah, absolutely.
But it must be fun to kind of look back at this point and have this experience.
Well, I only finished shooting at the beginning of February, so it's really, really.
And you finished cutting in the middle of March, or the?
Cutting.
When did you lock the film?
Like middle of March. Yeah. Well, really locking, yeah, April maybe.
The only person who does it that quickly is Steven Spielberg, you know.
He edits quickly?
Well, Michael Kahn is editing during the film, during production every time. So by the time they're finished shooting, within like 3 weeks, they have a cut.
It's useful.
Yeah.
You can still change things and so.
Well, it's good to be Steven Spielberg, too.
Sorry?
It's good to be Steven Spielberg.
Ah, for many reasons, and for many other not.
What's the not?
Well, I guess I don't want to talk badly about Mr. Spielberg now. I don't feel like I have the rights, but as many other filmmakers, I guess he lost his not at his best. Mm. He's not that interesting anymore.
Mm-hmm.
I guess I'm not the only one who thinks that.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Well, I guess his voice was being a kid on some level. It was always a story about kids, and I guess he's too old. You know, in your 60s, it's hard to be make movies about.
No, exactly.
A kid.
Yeah, yeah. But for example, I love Woody Allen. And he's still, from my point of view, really hitting hard.
Well, I think he finally shifted gears, and now it's like writing about other things. It's not quite as. You know.
But for example, Haneke, his new film is really as good as the last one.
Yeah.
That was hard to top.
And it's so completely different, which I think is the biggest surprise for people.
And it's amazing.
Yeah. So you're actually getting to films at the festival.
I'm trying. I spend a long time here, many days, in order to watch as many films as possible.
So anything else you're in love with?
The Among You was good. Yeah. And the Wes Anderson was really fun. I really, really like his work.